Well, I first moved to Monterey to become a news reporter and a news anchor at a local news station, and that was my route. That was my focal point. That I had studied that in college. I had dreamed of that, and for the longest time, that's what I thought I should do with my life. And so I moved here, was doing that, and got really involved in Shoreline, specifically the young adults ministry, and really found my home there, and found specifically my home in worship there. I sort of moved from young adults to high school group, and I started getting involved with the high school students as well as a high school leader here at Shoreline. When I was volunteering at high school, we didn't have a worship band, and we didn't have worship at our weekly high school gathering. And I started to just feel this weight that something needed to be done about that. And I felt that so strongly, and I prayed about it and thought, okay, I feel really underqualified. I really don't feel like I'm the right person to start a worship band for these high school students, but I think this is from you, God, so I'm gonna do it. I had a specific moment when I was leading worship at the Redefine Girls Conference last year, where I walked away from that and I felt this feeling, I kid you not, where I just thought that was what I was created to do. But now I, as a job, get to lead worship at the Young Adults Ministry. I get to lead the high school worship band. I get to lead worship on Sunday mornings, which is a huge blessing. I didn't even get to go to church a lot on Sunday mornings when I was at my old job. And now I get to lead worship at Night of Worships as well, and really invest in young worship leaders. I had a lot of people ask me, you know, why would you leave news? That's such a sought after, cool job. And it is a really cool job. It's fun and an adventure every day. Why would you leave that? But all I can say is, when you feel the Holy Spirit that strongly, where you just are like, wow, God, this is what you made me for, you have to say yes. You know, and at a lot of different workplaces and jobs, you can be all in that specific job that you're already in. Even when I was a news reporter, I had opportunities where I felt the Holy Spirit moving while I was out reporting, where I would have people, I was interviewing a homeless person and I felt like I was supposed to pray with them, and I did that, and I follow God's leading. But in my particular journey, I had this big jump that I felt God really calling me to make, and for me to go all in with my faith, that's what it took, and it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Huh. So I want to ask a question that's also an invitation. And the question is this: will you go all in and all out for the all in all who went all in and all out for you? Did you get that? Will you make a decision to go all in with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, all in and all out, whatever God calls you to do, for the all in all? And He is the all in all. He is the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, the Lord of the universe. Somebody say amen. I mean, we're talking about the God of the universe who loves us. Will you go all in and all out for the all in all? Because He went all in and all out on the cross and coming to this world and giving His life. He went all in and all out for you. That's the invitation of these next 4 weeks, to make a decision to live a life that's fully surrendered, that's all in for God. And that happens in a lot of times, in a lot of different ways. It happens in one moment, one specific moment, when you come to faith in Jesus. For me, it was just before I was 16 years old. And I understood the message of the cross, that Jesus died for our sins in our place on the cross. He rose in glory. He loved me, and He offered His forgiveness of sins. I had that moment where I said, I want to go all in for Jesus. There's that one moment when you receive Jesus. And I hope, if you haven't done that, I hope you'll do that soon. As a matter of fact, I hope you'll do that today. And commit your heart to follow Jesus. There's that moment, but there's also those big epic moments that you kind of come across in life, like we saw in the video with Bryn saying God was calling her to move from the newscasting world to serve in a church, a big change. For Sherry and I, when God called us to leave West Michigan and move to California and to be part of Shoreline Church, that was a major, that was just a little, okay, I'll do it. That's a big life shift. You know, will you, in those moments where God says, there's something really big I want to do. You're already a Christian, but I want to move you in a new way. Will you go all in and all out for the all in all? Because he went all in and all out for you. And then there's also just dozens, hundreds, thousands of little moments where God says, okay, now it's time to go all in this area, in this attitude that hasn't been right. It's time to go all in and get that attitude right. It's time to go all in with the way you love this person who's not acting very lovable. There's all these little moments through a normal day that God opens the door and calls us to go all in and all out for him. And I think sometimes we think of the Christian faith as, well, the Christian faith is just agreeing with certain beliefs. And let me tell you, agreeing with certain beliefs is very important in the Christian faith. There's things that we absolutely believe that the Bible teaches. But some people think that all the Christian faith is just, well, I agree with these five or six things. I believe that, therefore, I'm really living as a Christian. But going all in isn't just saying I believe certain things. It's saying I follow Jesus. I walk in his footsteps. I walk with him. I go on the adventure of faith of walking with Jesus. You know, the Bible says there's certain things that the demons believe. The demons believe and they tremble. But they're not Christians. They're not followers of Jesus. So our faith isn't just what we know in our minds. It's a walk with Jesus. It's living for Jesus. Will you go all in at that level? And also, sometimes we think that the Christian faith is a list of do's and don'ts. Well, you know, I became a Christian, so I stopped doing those seven things, and I started doing those five important things I do, and now that's what a Christian is. Now, being a Christian is, there's things that we stop doing, there's things that we start doing, that's part of it. But I really want to think together about what it means to be all in. And I think being all in is that we say, Jesus, I am on the great adventure. And the great adventure of knowing Jesus, the great adventure of the Christian faith, can be summarized in one word: follow. Follow. Where's Jesus going? I'm going to follow in his sandal prints. I'm going to follow in the footsteps of the rabbi, of the great teacher of Jesus, the God who left heaven and came to earth. I'm going to follow in his footsteps. Follow him that first time where I confess my sins and receive him, but follow him in those big moments and those little daily things. And that's what makes the Christian faith so exciting. If for you, the Christian faith is just five or six things you believe and a handful of things you don't do and you do, then you can contain the Christian faith in a little part of your life. Well, I got these certain beliefs, and I'm not doing that, I'm doing that. You know, I go to church faithfully and regularly once a month or, you know, twice a month, and I give a little bit in the offering plate, and I do, I try to help out somewhere. I've got these things I do. I'm in the club. But the faith of following Jesus is more than that. It's every day saying, where do you want me to go? What would you have me do? And that's dynamic. That's exciting. When you actually wake up in the morning and say, okay, Jesus, what's on the schedule for today? Surprise me. Amaze me. And I'll follow you. If you call me to go, I'll go. And if you call me to love, I'll love that person. And if you call me to be generous, I'll be generous. And if you call me to sacrifice, I'll sacrifice. And if you call me to forgive, I'll forgive like you forgave me. And that's an adventure. That's challenging. That's exciting. That's the Christian faith. That you become all in and you live all out for the all in all who went all in and all out for you, who gave his life on the cross, who died and who rose again. And so I want to invite you on this great adventure of just saying, I want to learn to follow Jesus in all circumstances, in all places. And the thing about Jesus is all through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where we read about his life on this earth, and even to this day, Jesus is regularly inviting us to follow him. He would often say when he walked on this earth, come follow me. And I think he says that to us today. And I don't want us to miss out on these great opportunities to follow Jesus. And I think we do. I think we miss out on these great opportunities. And I know in life, have you ever had a situation in life where someone invited you to do something or gave you an offer and you were like, eh, you just weren't there at that moment. You said, no, thanks. You didn't. And then later on you look back and you went, what was I thinking? How did I say no to that? That investment, that opportunity, that adventure, whatever it was. I said no, and I, as I was thinking about that, I thought of this one moment. A buddy of mine, about 10 years ago, I'd known him for about a year and a half, just getting to know him, And he's a guy that has a lot more resources than I have, and a lot more resources than most human beings on this planet have. And so he called me one day and he said, "Hey, I'm taking a group of friends golfing on a golf trip." He said, "It's going to be my treat. I'm going to cover the travel. I'm going to cover the golf. We're going to go to a place called Sand Hills, Nebraska." I didn't even know there were golf courses in Nebraska, but apparently there are. This is out in the middle of nowhere. He said, "Do you want to come on this golf trip?" And I looked at my schedule. I had a bunch of things on my schedule. I said, "Oh, you know, thanks for the offer, but nah, I think I got too much going on." About 20 minutes later, I'm sitting at my desk, and I'm thinking, what did I just do? You know, and I looked at my schedule, and I thought, well, there's a couple things there, but I could move them. I had vacation time. My wife is always telling me, go away. So that's not entirely true, but she loves when I can go do fun things with my buddies, you know. And so I knew that Sherry would be fine with it. So I picked up the phone. I called him back. I said, "Hey, listen, I'm in. I want to do it." "Sorry. Already gave your spot away." I said, "Really? It's been like 20 minutes." He said, "Yeah, you're in my top four. But once you said no, I went on to the next person on the list. And they said, yes, you're out." He doesn't have the gift of compassion. And so I'm sitting there. And then he gives me a little lesson. This is what he says. This is true. He says, let me tell you something. He says, "When I call you and ask you if you want to do something really fun, and I say, I'm paying," he says, "just say yes." He says, "Then take a couple days, check your schedule, and if you can't do it, call me back in a couple days and cancel. But at least say yes and get it." And so now when the phone rings, I see it's his number. I pick up, I just go, "Yes, I'm in, whatever, you know." But you know those moments where you go, I missed this opportunity. I want to look with you at missed opportunities and what could have been in the journey of Jesus. When Jesus walked on this earth, he said to people, "Come, follow me on this adventure." I mean, God in human flesh, walking on this planet, saying, "Hang out with me." That same God says the same thing to us. So I want you, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew. The Gospels in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are all stories of the life of Jesus. Amazing tellings, four different perspectives on the life of Jesus. And Matthew is the first of the four Gospels. In chapter four, we read this story. And this is a follow me moment where somebody went all in. Verse 18, as Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. And look at these three words: "Come, follow me. Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." Those three words from the heart and the lips of Jesus: "Come, follow me. Will you just make a decision to start walking with me, to follow after me, to go where I go, to do what I do? Come, follow me." And it's a beautiful moment, because what happens is Peter and Andrew, we see in the next verse, verse 20, at once, they left their nets and they followed him. Notice they didn't respond, "Yes, we'll follow you." They acted. The following of Jesus was more than just words, it was action. Jesus said, "Come, follow me." Immediately, they dropped their nets, and they just got behind Jesus, and they just started walking, following him. For the next 3 years, they got to see things, what eye could behold and experience to walk with and in the presence of God among us, Emmanuel. Man. And it all started with these words: "Come, follow me." I believe that Jesus says those words every single day. He says it originally to us, "Come follow me," so that we become his follower, confess our sins, and become a Christian. But when that happens in our lives, the journey doesn't stop. The journey starts. The adventure begins. And every day is saying, "I will follow Jesus." Where? Where? Wherever he calls me to go. I will follow Jesus. What are you going to do? Whatever he calls me to do. That's adventure. That's life. That's the Christian faith. Is it a list of things we believe? That's part of it. Is it things we do and don't do? Absolutely. But that's not the heartbeat. The heartbeat is that we follow Jesus. Jesus didn't say, "Come and believe the set of beliefs," or "Come and do certain things." He said, "Come, follow me." And then you learn to believe the right things and do the right things when you walk with Jesus. There's another story in the gospel. Same gospel, Matthew, a little bit later, chapter 19. Another person comes to Jesus and has this "follow me all in" moment, but they respond differently. Look with me at Matthew chapter 19, beginning in verse 16. Just then a man came up to Jesus and asked, "Teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life?" "Why do you ask me about what is good?" Jesus replied. "There's only one who is good. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments. He's talking about the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20. If you want to enter life, keep the commandments. Which ones? The man inquired. Now, hit the pause button for a minute. This guy says, which commandments? Now, remember, there's 10 commandments. The first four are about how we relate to God. The next six are about how we relate to other people. It's interesting that Jesus lists five of the six commandments about how we relate with people, but he leaves one out for a very particular reason. So maybe you'll identify which one he leaves out as I read the five. So which ones? The man inquired. Jesus replied, you shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. And then this general, and love your neighbor as yourself. Look at the guy's response. Now remember, he's talking to God in human form. It's kind of a bold statement. I have kept these. You know, all these I have kept, the young man said. What do I still lack? And so Jesus goes to the one of the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not covet, want what other people have. It's about stuff. Because Jesus knew something, that for this guy, there was this anchor in his soul that kept him kind of to where he was and from following Jesus or anything else because he loved stuff. He loved money more than he loved anything else. So Jesus wants to set him free from that so he can then do the most important thing, follow Jesus. Jesus answered verse 21. If you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then listen to the words. Then come follow me. Now, what Jesus isn't saying is the way to get to heaven is sell what you have and give it to the poor. It's great. We're called to be generous to the poor, but that would be being saved by our works. Oh, I'm saved because I sold my stuff and gave it to the poor. We're saved by grace. What Jesus is saying is the way you get saved is by following me. And the one thing that's holding you back is that you love stuff so much. You covet. You want things more than you want me or anything else. So Jesus says, cut yourself loose from that, and then you can do what it is that saves a person. Come, follow me. Walk with Jesus. Follow Jesus. Confess your sins. Receive him. Walk with him and follow him. Now watch how this story ends. This is a follow me moment missed. He says, I'm out. When the young man heard this, he went away sad because he had great wealth. Like Peter and Andrew responded with actions, he responded with actions. Peter and Andrew, Jesus says, come follow me. And they see where Jesus is going. They see where he's going. And they drop their nets and they just start walking, following Jesus. They start the adventure of following Jesus. This guy hears the words of Jesus, come follow me. And what does he do? He turns the other direction. Jesus is going that way. And in his sadness, he walks away from Jesus. Because there was something that was keeping him anchored to what he wanted versus what Jesus wanted for him. Man. What a moment. And I think about that young man, what he could have seen, what he could have experienced had he just simply left behind what he needed to leave behind. It's different for each of us. There's things that hold us back. We have to leave those behind. For Peter and Andrew, it was nets. For this guy, it was stuff. But what it means to be a Christian is to follow Jesus and leave behind whatever we need to leave behind. Now, here's the spiritual reality. All of us have something that we have let take a hold of us, that we follow, that we pursue, that we're all about, that consumes our thoughts and our hearts and our minds and our lives. There's things that we follow and hold on to, and they can get in the way of following the one who matters most, Jesus. And so the question I want to ask is this, you know, what do you follow? What is it that you are pursuing, that your life is about? And is it what matters most? For some people, it's this. And if you're a note taker, there's a place in the outline to write a few notes here. For some people, what they follow is religious regulations. For some people, they follow religion. Do you know you can follow religion and not be following Jesus? Did you know that? There's all kinds of religions, and religions have rules and regulations. And so for some people, they're following religious regulations. And they say, well, you know, I show up at church, I put money in the offering plate, I help out, I do this, I don't do that, I do all the things. They may not have a love for Jesus, they may not pursue Jesus, but they have a list of stuff that is the religious stuff. And that doesn't save. Religion doesn't save, Jesus does. And holding to religious observations, there's things that are wonderful in our faith, but our faith is really centered on Jesus Christ. For some people, what do they follow? Cultural carrots. You know what a cultural carrot is? You know the old carrot on the stick? If you got a horse or a mule and you want it to pull a load, you just kind of put a stick out with a string and a carrot just about a foot from their nose, And they just keep walking to try to get to the carrot, and they just keep walking after the carrot. They never get to the carrot, but they keep pursuing it. For some people, there's cultural carrots. There's things that consume their hearts and their minds. So it's like, my life is about getting the right job. And if I can get the right job and be successful in my job, that's my whole life. And God gets a little sliver over here, but my life is all about this career pursuit. And that ought not to be the primary thing in our lives, but for many of us it is. For a cultural carrot could be just the idea of success. Or the idea of accomplishment. I have this goal that I want to accomplish, but it's cultural carrots that we're pursuing. Another thing that we can follow is secret sins. Our life can be consumed with these hidden secret sins that own us, that rule our lives. Lust, the love of our hearts and our minds being kind of captured by sensualities. That's become so much a part of our culture, and it becomes a secret sin for some people. Revenge. I've watched people just wither away because they've been so deeply hurt by somebody that the rest of their life, they wouldn't say it, or sometimes they would say it, but they're just consumed with this, I want to get back, and they nurse their pain and their anger, and it becomes the thing that consumes their lives. It's their driving force of their life. It's heartbreaking. For some people, it's pleasure. And it's just about, remember in high school, some of you are still in high school, there's always those people in high school that their whole life is just about Friday night. And it's just waiting for the party, waiting to hang out, waiting, you know, just to kind of blow off life and just, you know, play and drink and do whatever they can. Just, okay, it's my weekly celebration. That's all that matters. Then you meet the same person. For me, I've met people 5 years later, 10, 20, 30, people in their 40s, 50s, 60s. They haven't changed. Hate my job. Hate my life. But on Friday, oh, man, I'm going to get together. I'm going to, and it's like, man, that's their life. It's just surviving so they can have a Friday celebration. Is that all that life is? But that becomes this sort of just this nurturing, this I want what I want to make me happy. Secret sins, religious regulations, cultural carrots, secret sins, demanding dreams. For some people, their whole pursuit is this dream that's been put in front of them, maybe by their parents. Someday you'll be this or you'll have this. They haven't even named it. Now their life's going by and it's just they're trying to pursue this dream to make their parents happy. Or maybe it's a dream they put on themselves. I want this. I want to accomplish this. And their whole life is just trying to get to that, to what that is, to that dream that is all, and it tends to be almost perfection. So we can never get there. We can strive and strive and strive. And the dilemma is when we spend our lives following religious regulations, going after cultural carrots, nurturing secret sins, pursuing demanding dreams that we're never going to accomplish, we miss out on what really life is about. And here it is in two words. Just Jesus. Just Jesus. It was Jesus who said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And this is what Jesus says. And all these things will be added to you. He says, seek Jesus first. Follow Jesus. And as you follow Jesus, The hunger and passion for the right romantic relationship. Jesus kind of leads you where you need to go. As you follow Jesus, the right career, the right direction, the right way to view that, Jesus fulfills it. Where you want satisfaction and joy, the Holy Spirit brings the joy that you long for. When you pursue Jesus, all that other stuff that can sort of capture your heart and your life, it gets fulfilled in the right way. There's nothing like following Jesus. And we talk about being all in. If you're going to be all in, with your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength, and all out, fully surrendered for the all in all, for God Almighty, who went all in and all out by giving his life on the cross, leaving the glory of heaven and loving you. When you pursue that, you find out what life is meant to be. And it is truly glorious and truly amazing. And it is an adventure. There's nothing boring about walking with Jesus. It's always exciting. There's always new things to experience when you follow Jesus. So my question is this, what does an all-in life look like? What does it look like when your life is all in? There's a great story in this book, and this is, I always like to let people know that this series we're doing is, we're using some of the teachings of a guy named Mark Batterson. He wrote a book entitled All In. And actually, Sharon and I had the privilege of writing the small group guide that goes with this book with Mark Batterson. This book has got some great stories, and I'm not using a lot of the stuff from the book because I encourage you to buy a copy of the book. We have them, I think, at our cost over by the cafe, and you can buy a copy and go deeper into this topic. I'd encourage you to do it. It's a great, very readable, very kind of interesting book. But he tells a story. Mark Batterson tells a story in here that I used one time as an illustration when I was preaching after I had first read the book a couple years ago. It's a story from about 100 years ago. These people, they called the one-way missionaries. People that became Christians and they wanted to share the love of Jesus. And they would literally get a one-way ticket, not a round-trip ticket, a one-way ticket to some part of the world where people needed to hear about Jesus. And they would pack their possessions, not in suitcases, but in a casket. They'd have their own wood casket. They would pack their belongings in that casket, nail it shut, take it to the mission field, and they would stay there and teach about Jesus till they died and they were buried in that place in that casket. Now that's all in, all right? That's you know. And I kind of want to say, well, but Jesus isn't calling you to that. But can I tell you something? In a way, he is. Because when someone becomes a follower of Jesus, the scripture that Pastor Steve read today during our giving back time, you know, Jesus calls them to follow him. He says, deny yourself every day, take up your cross, and follow me. What does it mean to take up your cross? It means to be willing to die. You know, the cross is a place where Jesus was crucified. If you're going to be a Jesus person, just deny yourself every day. It's not going to be about me. Take up your cross. I'm willing to give my whole life for Jesus. And Jesus said, and follow me. Follow me. So you may not be called to go into the mission field and pack your belongings in a casket, but if you're a Christian, what if every day we woke up and said, Jesus, this day is completely yours, and I belong to you, and I am all in and all out because you are the all in all, and you went all in and all out for me. So you can have my life today. And then that night you put your head on the pillow at the end of the day and you say, okay, you didn't call me to die today, but I lived for you. And I said, Jesus, what do you want me to do? And who do you want me to love? And how do you want me to serve? And what, just guide me and I will follow you. That's the adventure of the Christian life. That's exciting. And our best example, our perfect example of an all-in life, if you want the absolute best, if you want to look at someone who lived all in, his name is Jesus Christ. He went all in and he went all out for you and for me, even when we didn't deserve it. And I want you to listen to God's word. I want to read a couple passages to you. And it's not going to be on the screen. I just want you to hear what the Bible says about this Jesus, what he did. Because you can't go all in every day of your life until you have that first all in when you receive Jesus. So who is this Jesus? What has he done? What has he given? In Philippians chapter 2, Philippians 2, beginning of verse 6. It says we should have this mindset that's in Christ Jesus. And here's the mindset we should have, because this is what Jesus did. It says, who being in very nature God, this is Jesus, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing. This is God Almighty. He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's all in. Jesus left the glory of heaven, infinite God. And somehow, in a mystery we can't comprehend, he poured himself out and came as one of us and died on a cross for us and for our sins. About 740 years before that happened, before Jesus came to this earth, the prophet Isaiah prophesied of this one who would come, of this Messiah, of Jesus. And here's what Isaiah prophesied about Jesus. He said, surely he took up our pain and he bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace, that punishment was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. For we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That Jesus took our sins and he took our shame and he took our punishment and he took our judgment and he bore it on the cross. It's prophesied 740 years before it happened. And then, just one more passage. In Romans chapter 5, in Romans 5, beginning of verse 6, it just paints so clearly the picture of this all-in Jesus who went all in and all out for us. We read this in Romans 5, 6. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. That's us everyone who wandered. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Wow. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him, through Jesus? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? If God loved us when we were still his enemies and hated him, oh, how much does he love us when we've had our all-in moment and received Jesus and seek to follow him? And we do walk with him and follow him, and we do it imperfectly. We don't live perfectly. We don't do everything right all the time. And God knew that, and so while we were sinners, Christ died. So here's my question. Have you come to an all-in follow Jesus moment? Have you had that moment for the first time where you understood the greatness of God's love, the reality of your sins and your wrongs, and the price that Jesus paid on the cross? And if you come to Jesus and said, I accept your grace, I accept your forgiveness, I will now follow you all the days of my life and into eternity. Have you come to that moment? And if you haven't, before the service is done, I want to give you a chance to pray and to come to that moment. But also, have you had those moments throughout your day where God speaks to you and says it's time to get all in that area of your life? I decided the first of the year to start reading the book of Proverbs. And every day I'm reading the book of Proverbs, I'm praying, I'm journaling, I'm letting it guide my prayers, and I'm saying, God, take the words of the wisdom of the book of Proverbs from the Old Testament and just speak to my heart. So I was thinking back to from today back to the first of the year, I got like a dozen areas, I'm not kidding, where God has had taken me to all-in moments. Where God says, Kevin, I know you love me, I know you're following me, I know you've come to the cross. But the book of Proverbs talks about our words and using words that are wise and not speaking things we shouldn't speak. And the Holy Spirit says, Kevin, you need to get all in with your words. I've been convicted about that. You know, pride and humility. I've had a moment where God has said, Kevin, you need to have greater humility in your heart. And there's just, you know, how you take care of your health, how you treat other people, all these different things. So I got like 12 all-in moments with God since the first year. So I've stopped reading Proverbs. And no, I haven't. I was on chapter 23 this morning, and God spoke to my heart this morning. He did. There's an adventure. You know, and is it hard sometimes, and do you feel stretched when the Holy Spirit keeps challenging you to grow and to say you're not following Jesus fully, and you need to get all in? Is that tough sometimes? Yes, it is, but that's how we're made to live. There's an adventure in that. There's a joy in that. And I'd rather be following Jesus when it's tough than walking away from Jesus and have it be easy, because walking away from Jesus is never easy. He loves us too much. He's not going to let us run. But have you had those all-in moments? And I hope you do. I hope that you experience God speaking and leading and guiding. Be in the scriptures. Listen for the Spirit, still small voice. And here's what happens. When we get to that place where we say, I will surrender myself to Jesus. That first time where we say, I will follow him, confess my sin, and become a Christian, be born again. Or that thousandth time where God speaks to you and says, now it's time to grow in this area, or to get back on track in this area. Part of our all-in journey isn't just that one moment, it's the thousand moments that happen where God speaks and says, now it's time to follow me in this way. What happens when we get all in with Jesus? Here's what happens. First of all, and if you're a note taker, jot these down. We stop asking Jesus to follow us. When you get all in, you stop asking Jesus to follow us. You know those moments where you go, oh, hey, God, listen up. I got a great plan. Have I got something planned for us? So we tell God what we got planned, and we say, God, get in line, follow me, here we go. I want you to bless my thing. When you get all in, you stop doing that. And you say, Jesus, where are you going? I will follow you, because you see, he's Lord, not me. When this happens, we declare, thy will be done and not my will be done. We say, God, I want your will to be done. Because when we begin to walk in his will, we find out that that's the deepest desire of our hearts. We realize that Jesus is the center of the universe and not me. But before you just start living an all-in life, even as a Christian sometimes, we can have this idea that here's the center of the universe, it's me, and everything revolves around me, and everything is made in the world to satisfy me. And I think more and more in our culture, there's this idea that we can even be raised to believe that everything really matters is me, and everything revolves around me. And when you get to a place where you're living all-in, you say, God is the center of the universe, and my life revolves around His will and His ways. That changes everything. And also when this happens, we hunger for God with growing passion. We hunger more and more to know Him, to love Him, to be loved by Him, to walk with Him, to follow Him. We hunger more and more. And because Jesus comes and says, come follow me, we decide if we want to follow. So I think of the rest of the story with the rich young ruler. You know how the rich young ruler's story ended? No, you don't. Neither do I. It's not in the Bible. We don't know. He said, I want my stuff more than I want Jesus. And he walked the other direction. And we never really hear from him again. But Peter's story. Peter and Andrew, they left their nets. They followed Jesus. Man, you can read through the Gospels, the adventure of walking with Jesus. Then when Jesus dies on the cross and rises again, what followed? What an adventure. And Peter became one of the primary leaders in the early church. And so you look at, so Peter leaves his nets and he follows Jesus. And from that moment on, of course, everything goes smoothly for Peter and it's really easy and he always does the right thing, right? No, if you know the story of Peter, Peter messed up a lot. I mean, Peter's the one that when Jesus has been arrested, before he goes to the cross, Jesus has been arrested, and Peter had said, I'll die with you. I'll die for you. I'll never deny you. And Peter says, when he's asked, aren't you one of those followers of Jesus? No, I don't know what you're talking about. And the second time they ask him, he says, I swear I don't know Jesus. The third time he's asked, he says, may I be cursed if I know him? I don't know the man. He said all that with Jesus watching and hearing. And he wept bitterly. His heart was broken over his own weakness, his own betrayal of Jesus. And then Jesus dies on the cross. And 3 days later, he rises again in glory. And he shows up to Peter on the Sea of Galilee. And he says to Peter, Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? He asked him three times, because three times he'd said, I don't know Jesus. I don't know Jesus. I swear I don't know the guy. And every time Peter says, I love you. And every time Jesus tells him that I still want to, the adventure's not over yet. I love this in the Gospel of John, chapter 21, verse 15. Jesus says to him, after Peter affirms his love, Jesus says, feed my lambs. Verse 16, Jesus says, take care of my sheep. Verse 17, Jesus says, feed my sheep. Over and over and over. Jesus says, Peter, the adventure's not over yet. You can still follow me. And after Jesus ascended, Peter kept following Jesus. And the last thing that Jesus said to Peter, I love this, in chapter 21 of the Gospel of John, verse 22, he says, Peter, you must follow me. Peter, you must follow me. It's not over. When we mess up, when we aren't living the way we're supposed to live, and we know it, we can be like, oh, he's given up on me. I can't really follow Jesus anymore. Oh, man. Praise God that he uses people like Peter who deny and he restores. And he says, now, Peter, remember when I first met you on the Sea of Galilee? Remember when I said, come follow me? You dropped the nets, you started following me. I'm telling you, you must follow me. Peter, just keep living this life. Follow me. Jesus, where are you going? I'll go there. Jesus, who are you going to love and who are you going to care for? I'll love them too. Jesus, how are you going to serve? I'll serve too. Jesus, what are you going to do? I'm going to be part of that. That's the adventure of the Christian life. That's living the all-in life. It's moment by moment saying, where's Jesus going? What's Jesus doing? I'm in. I'm part of it. I'm following Jesus. And some of you today, for some of you today, you haven't had that first all-in moment where you've said, for the first time, I want to say, I'm following Jesus. I'll confess my wrongs, my sins. I don't have a perfect life. I'll accept Jesus' death on the cross and the sacrifice he paid, and I will receive Jesus. Some of you need to make that commitment today. I want to challenge you to do that. For some of you, I want to challenge you to make a commitment to actually engage in the life of the church. I have a class today at 1 o'clock, right in the cafe, new members class. For some of you, you've been part of Shoreline for a long time. We just did a 3-week series on the church. Why bother? And our answer was there's lots of good reasons to bother with being part of the church. I want to challenge some of you that have time at 1 o'clock to join me at 1 o'clock today and just say, I want to know more about becoming part of the church. My all-in thing is going to be I'm going to get engaged in the church in a way I never have before. And I'll talk to you about that today at 1 o'clock. And then for some of you, it's just those little things. You love Jesus. You believe in him. You're following Jesus. But there's something right now in your life that the Holy Spirit is saying, now it's time to really surrender and follow me in that area. Like I said, I've had a dozen of them in the last 3.5 weeks, just through the book of Proverbs. And I don't think I'm the only one out there that's not perfectly walking with Jesus, that's learning still, that's growing. And I want to challenge you to say, Jesus, is there an area you want me to follow you all in? So I want to go to prayer right now. I want to pray through those three things and let you talk to the Lord. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, speak to our hearts. As we're here together in this space here, as we're here in the family worship venue, as we have people in this church that are online following along. And I want to pray right now for those people that have never made that first time commitment to follow you, Jesus, to say, I will surrender my life, I will follow you, I want to become a Christian, a follower of Jesus. And I want to speak right now to those in Monterey and those in the family worship venue right now. In the family worship venue, Pastor John's there. And in a moment, when I ask you to raise your hand and look up, you'll look up at him and he'll make eye contact. And if you're online and you want to make a commitment to follow Jesus, would you just send a note to Ben Spangler, who's online with you, one of our pastors, and he'll interact with you online. But here in the worship center, in the family worship venue, I want to ask you right now, if you've never said yes to Jesus, you've never said, I want to become his follower, accept his forgiveness, and start this journey of following Jesus. I want to become a Christian, a follower of Jesus. If that's you today, I want to ask that you would just do this one thing. You would raise your hand high in the air and look up at me and make eye contact so I can see you, and I want to lead you in a prayer, but I want to know who I'm praying for. And so just right now, if you'll just raise your hand and look up at me, I want to be able to pray for you with a face in front of me. Anybody say for the first time? Okay, look there. Look right at me. Okay, good. Thanks. Right there. I'll pray for you in just a moment. Is there anybody else? Just raise your hand high. Okay, over here. Okay, right there. Thank you. Right there in the very front row of the balcony. Look up at me right there. Okay, good. Right there. Good. Anybody else? For the first time. Okay, right there. Good. Thank you. Anybody else? And if you have your hand up and you're in a darker spot in the worship center and I can't see you, God sees your hand. I want you to join me in this prayer. Over here in the balcony. Okay. All right. And if you want to pray right now, would you just in your heart right now between you and God, will you pray this prayer? Dear Lord Jesus, I haven't lived a perfect life. I need your forgiveness and grace. I confess my sins and my wrongs. And I accept the grace of Jesus. And I ask for his power to fill me so I can follow after him all the days of my life and into eternity. And if you prayed that prayer, the Holy Spirit is entering your life right now and you're washed clean. And I want to invite you, right when the service is done, to come up front here and just give me 5 minutes to say a prayer with you, to give you a Bible and just give you a big hug and welcome you into the family of God and this life of Shoreline as a committed person following Jesus. So come forward right after the service is done. I want to ask those of you that are here today and in the family worship venue and online, if you consider Shoreline your church home and you have never taken the time to join the church, I want to ask you to pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord Jesus, commit my heart not just to you, but commit my heart to your people, the church. Help me find my place in the life of your body. Help me serve faithfully. Help me give generously. Help me love passionately and strengthen your church because I'm part of it. And then finally, I want to ask you, if you're here today in the worship center, in the family worship venue, if you have an area of your life, maybe a little small one, maybe a big one, and you say, right now, I really believe God's calling me to go all in and to surrender myself more than I have in this area of my life. And I'm saying right now, I want to pray right now, God, I want to go all in this area. If that's you, just you don't have to look up. Just raise your hand high for about 5 seconds. Just raise your hand high and say, there's some area of my life that I'm going all in. Just raise your hand high. Good. Okay, just all over the place. Good. If there's a specific area on your heart, good. And keep that area in your mind right now as we pray together. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, there's many of us that just know that we love you, we believe in you, we're walking with you, but there's areas that we want to surrender. And Lord, in the specific area you've put in people's hearts right now, I believe that's by your Holy Spirit. Give them power now to surrender, to follow you, to live for you in that area of their life. And for all those that are here today that believe in you, Jesus, I pray in this coming week, we'll open your word, we'll pray, we'll listen for your Spirit, and there'll be areas that we hear you say, go all in. Follow Jesus with new passion and new commitment. Lord, may we surrender ourselves and follow you completely and absolutely in every area of our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. I want to give you two invitations before you head out, so just stay seated for 1 second. Number one, at 1 o'clock today, we have a new members class in the cafe. I'll be leading that. Come and join me at 1 o'clock if you want to do that. And then number two, this Wednesday, 6:15, night of worship. It's going to be amazing. God's showing up. I hope you do. But it's going to be a great time of worship right here in the worship center, 6:15 this Wednesday night. If you want prayer, come forward for prayer. If you're new, go by the Connection Center and just tell them you're new and they want to give you a gift and thank you for coming and get to know you. And if you prayed to receive Jesus today, I'd love to give you a hug right here and give you a Bible and have a prayer with you. So come join me right here. Go live all in for Jesus. Amen. And have a great week.